forum tonight, and we found out rather late to cancel things. So we have reposted the agenda items that we plan to vote on for Wednesday night. That's the 23rd. Wednesday the 23rd. So I apologize.
We're meeting on Wednesday the 23rd.
And the public, yeah, potentially, yeah.
We had to post it tonight for Wednesday night.
So tonight we will do reports, and we'll have the literacy presentation. So you want to start with reports? Stop.
Sorry, I was just putting it in my calendar. I just wanted to mention that I went to Nico Calabria today at Parker. He is an understanding disability speaker, and he's just a regular guy, but he only has one leg. He was missing when he was born. Didn't have half of his hip and his leg, and he talked about, with UD, he talked about everyone being the same on the inside, but he went even farther. He talked about, with his disability, it's evident that he has an extra challenge, which he doesn't view necessarily as a disability, but rather as he has one leg. He's not missing a leg. It was an interesting twist on attitude. But he also invited the kids to think about those who have challenges, but they're not visible, and to have compassion. And I thought it was really remarkable that he was talking about that today, when Challenge Day happened at Coolidge and Parker last week, because it was a really nice reminder for the eighth graders of what they had gone through the week before. And I know there'll be an update on Challenge Day, but I just wanted to highlight how the programs went together. And just a quick update, and I know Ms. Wilson will be talking about the CPAC, but we had a follow-up. They're hard at work on creating the bylaws, and so just kudos to the people that have stepped up to the plate, to Alicia Williams and her board, and the board, and I won't go long into that, but I really appreciate the work they're doing, because it'll be great for us to collaborate together around the needs of our students.
We had our CASA meeting on this past Thursday night, and it was a night kind of a bittersweet meeting. It was Chief Cormier's last meeting, and Erica McNamara did a very nice job doing a PowerPoint presentation chronicling, I guess, from when he started it. And I guess the fact I didn't know, I knew he was one of the original founders, from a staff standpoint, he's the last one, because yes, it was himself, Pat Scatini, and
Peter
Heckenblatt. I think that she did a very nice job. The other thing I wanted to mention is I have decided to pull papers, which I did today, for re-election, for another 3 years. And I thought about it for a while. You don't want to wear out your welcome, but I think that I can be a positive contributor and to the committee, and I would like to do that. So, thank you. Any other?
I'll go first. So, as was just discussed, we did have a special ed PAC meeting on December 11th. They are working on their bylaws and trying to finalize their bylaws. I also had a parent meeting that night as well on transportation. We had about 10 families who came, and North Reading Transportation came as well, and Martha was there. And we just answered questions about the process. The second big piece of information is that the POST program, which is our post-grad program, is going to be moving to their Wakefield location after the vacation. Tomorrow night, they're having a sneak peek, and I'll send an invitation. You guys are welcome to go for a walkthrough of the site. It's from 6 to 7 tomorrow evening. They said to please wear flat and sensible shoes because it is a construction site. But the plan is that when we return from the December break, that the students will be going over and doing some moving in and visiting the site, and then hopefully by Thursday, January 7th, they will actually be starting their day and going there. So we're excited for them to move into their new space. We're sad to have them leave, but we're excited that they'll have this space and really have their own home. So, my two reports.
Thank you.
I only have one. We met earlier from 5:30 to 6:30 with a wonderful group of budget parents. We're excited about the process. And as I mentioned to them, I'm in budget heaven, and we will keep moving forward. We'll keep moving forward. Absolutely. I also attended a challenge day, but I think Mr. Moon's going to talk about that.
I think all of us had the chance, I think, the privilege of, for both of our middle schools participated in the Challenge Day event with their 8th grade. I had the privilege of attending a Parker event on Thursday, I guess it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the kids were absolutely, when I say privileged to attend, it truly was. The kids were amazing, just absolutely inspiring. The way that they supported each other and come together, the sense of community. For those people who might not be aware of what this was the second year. It was done last year with Coolidge, and it's one group at the high school. Mm-hmm. So there were a lot of discussions afterwards, after the powerful feedback that we got back of how to continue it in the district. And it really is a program to help promote empathy and understanding of each other's differences. That there's more to everybody than maybe how we're judged sometimes by our appearances and all of those sorts of things. And all the last several days I've been getting emails from staff, from kids' reactions, staff reactions, parent reactions, how positive it was. I pulled, because I realized some people may not be aware, we're still now getting the data and feedback for this year, but I looked back at last year's results from kids, where every single student who participated completed surveys a few days afterwards. Things like, and I don't think we ever get this type of feedback after events, where over 75% are saying because they participated in Challenge Day, they're more likely to feel safe at school. Over 80% say they now feel more connected to other students and adults in the school. Over 82% saying they feel more hopeful about their future. Over 90% feel they're much more aware of the effects of bullying on students. I love this. Almost 90% say they're more hopeful that a school where people treat each other with respect and acceptance is possible. And over 85% thought the skills that they learned participating in the day will be helpful to them in their own personal life. As a middle school teacher myself for many years, I thought, boy, I'm not even sure some of our academic subjects get that sort of ratings, at least from kids. We know that they can be applicable, but from a kid's point of view, that it's so applicable to their lives. It's very meaningful. So we'll be working with all of the staff, people that were involved, to figure out how we can even improve it. If it's something we are wanting to continue in the future, based on the feedback, I think it's definitely something worth exploring. How we can better communicate. Before and after, because certainly the first year it's hard when something's new to make sure everybody's understanding what's happening. If anyone else wanted to add anything about that.
This is a question. I know I was supposed to attend and I had a family emergency, but was it just the 8th grade last year at Coolidge that
it
participated?
Was, yes.
Now, wasn't this in part a REF funded
last
piece
year.
Last year.
Yeah.
Okay, so but it was open to all the schools, but only some participated last year. True. Right.
No, the REF grant did fund the Coolidge piece last year.
Oh, okay.
There was not, and we did some, we did have some, one group at the high school.
There were some Coolidge staff members, I believe, that initiated the grant.
The grant, right.
Yeah.
Okay, but this year it was both Coolidge and Parker, eighth grade.
And it was PTO and private funding, a private donation that funded this year. The PTOs funded the lodging and transportation, and then we had private donation that funded the rest of it.
That's excellent.
I will say the facilitators or counselors with their title, they're amazing. I mean, again, I think with middle school students in large groups and how they facilitate and make that day move is absolutely amazing. I know they go through extensive training to do that well, and it was great. And kids are still talking about it. It's something I think they will never forget long after they graduate from the Reading Public Schools. And even for staff to be saying it's opened their eyes. I had a staff member just today in a meeting say to me they thought it was professional development because it opened their eyes to see their students in different ways.
In a different way.
That all of us, you know, have various things and challenges. I think a big takeaway is for kids is that they're not alone, because what, you're 13 or 14, you think whatever things that you're going through, it's just you, and you realize, no, absolutely everybody, whether it's yourself, it's somebody you care about, there are different challenges in life. So that's a big takeaway. And then, of course, even more importantly, that they can, we all have the power to be the change we want to see.
Mm-hmm.
If we all just decide we're going to do that for each other and support each other in that way. And so it's, yeah, it was just really inspiring to see kids do that for each other. And it's, yeah, it was amazing.
I just wanted to quickly say thank you to the PTOs and a thank you to Northern Bank. And there was an anonymous funder as well, but Northern Bank also helped fund this. And it's nice that the community pitched in to make this, enable us to do this program.
Yes.
I guess I just want to say that I think the data that you reported about, you know, feeling more hopeful, I think that's huge from so many points of view. I mean, just the world around us, and you look at what's coming at students, so to feel more hopeful, to feel more safe, you know, that goes to the social and emotional health, you know, well-being, which then, you know, translates if we, I mean, Pat always said it, but it's simplified, right? You have to learn to be healthy and be healthy to learn. It's way bigger than that. But so that's really a great plus 100% response rate on the survey, and then to get those kinds of results from a program is just totally amazing. So I look forward to my invitation and participation next year.
How was that survey? Is that a true false type? So you write the questions?
So there's a series of, I have it, I don't know how many prompts, maybe 25, 30 different prompts, including would you recommend it to your family or friends? And it was like 91% said yes. So it's you. Most of them are, how strongly do you agree, strongly agree, agree.
Mm-hmm.
So the figures I quoted are either agree or strongly agree.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some prompts, like any good survey, that you're, you know, ideally, you know, you would not necessarily agree, you would want to disagree.
Right, right, so that you know people aren't.
So they're not just marking, it kind of goes back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, right.
Are there any excerpts from that, maybe down the road? Is that something that you could do, like a YouTube thing, just so and post somewhere? I mean, something that wouldn't embarrass somebody, obviously.
Sure.
I'm just curious.
We are doing a presentation for the school committee, I believe, in February. On Challenge Day.
Oh, great.
Yes.
The Challenge Day program also has a YouTube video and a website, so you can see not necessarily our children, because it is there's a confidentiality issue, but you can see the program in action on the website. They have clips.
Yeah, no, I was more interested in our, you said what I was thinking is probably there's some competition.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you.
I just had one item. Oh, I had two items, actually. So Wednesday night on the agenda is the Parker Middle School search timeline that the committee will approve. I do want to correct a headline that was in the Chronicle this evening. That we're looking for a principal for Coolidge. That is not accurate. If you read the story, it talks about a Parker Middle School search. So anyone that saw that headline and didn't read further, it is for Parker Middle School that And we did begin advertising last week for that and posting the position. So Wednesday night, the committee will review that timeline and vote on it. But I just wanted to clear up that it is not Coolidge, it's Parker.
Such a relief to Mrs. Marshall.
Yes, exactly. The other item I just want to report out is last week, on occasion, the Middlesex League superintendents do meet as a group. On a regular basis, the high school principals and the athletic directors meet more to focus on athletic issues or other common academic issues among high schools. But last week, the Middlesex League superintendents met, and we talked about a variety of things, but I think the thing that you'll be most interested in is that as a group, we voted, and it was non-binding, but it was I think it was important and symbolic, is that all of us are going to be, within the next 3 years, taking a look at our start times at the high school and making changes, which is important as a league to do that, mm-hmm. For a variety of reasons. But it is on the radar of the Middlesex League superintendents. So within the next 3 years, you will see changes at all the high schools for start times.
Mm. Yes.
So I'm glad to hear that. I was in Virginia a couple of weeks ago, or the last 2 weeks, and the thing I noticed, though, too, is it's a little lighter, longer than it is here. And, you know, thinking about that, I'm like, you know, thinking about, you know, the cross country. And so there's a lot of, you know, obviously it's great that the league, Middlesex League, but we also do a lot of competition outside the league. So I think, you know, from an athletic viewpoint, that we need to also be looking at that and see what that impact is. I recognize it's like those might not count, but a lot of the teams, you know, do that. So I mean, there's a lot of...
Well, I think our thinking is if one league does it, I think you'll start seeing other leagues follow mm-hmm. suit, and why not Middlesex League?
Right. Well, that's great. It'll probably encourage other leagues or other groups of superintendents to sort of do the same thing.
That's obviously only one factor that
yeah.
goes into that.
Oh,
decision.
Yeah.
Right. But I think it's important that the whole league recognizes that this is important. Mm-hmm. And we are one of the earlier starts. There's a lot of high schools in the Middlesex League that start at 7:35 or 7:45. Arlington actually starts at 8 o'clock. We are one of the earlier ones at 7:30.
That's why their buses are always late here. It's good.
That's all I have for reports.
Craig, did you want to
go ahead? So, yeah, as you know, over the last few years, we have been, as the state framework has made some shifts in our standards, we've been working to implement some new curriculum programs to align our instructional strategies to go along with those programs. We've been putting some new structures in place to really sort of reimagine how our professional collaboration, professional development happens with our PLCs, the professional learning communities, teacher leadership, the curriculum leaders, our administrator liaisons that are sort of assigned to each different content area, our new coach positions, which have been doing a great job. And so we thought we'd use tonight to sort of give you a little summary on a couple of items. I've asked our coaches to be a part of the presentation and focus primarily on the elementary level with some shifts that we're making in literacy, specifically in writing. And then also in math, as you know, we've now, this is the third year of our Math in Focus program, to talk about sort of why that was necessary and how we're approaching some of those shifts and where we are in that progress. So we have Karen Brown here, who is our mathematics coach, K-8 math coach, Tricia Stodden, who is our K-8 literacy coach, and then for moral support.
I'm their biggest.
She is. And Joanne King, principal of Wood End, is also, one of her roles is the literacy liaison for the elementary level. And so she's been a part of a lot of this as well. So I'm going to turn it over to Karen and Tricia. I think, Karen, you start off, right?
So I'm pleased to be here. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I really want to talk about some of the shifts that have taken place in mathematics education. I think if you look back prior to 2011 and you looked at the old curriculum frameworks, they were arranged so that they were a two-year span. Mm-hmm. So it would be grades 1-2, then 3-4. And I think it was very difficult for teachers to know what they should be teaching when. The sequence wasn't necessarily spelled out, especially if you weren't a math specialist. So if you were at the elementary level, unless you had a really solid, coherent curriculum, it was very difficult for you to know what was best for your students. The current frameworks really emphasize coherence. So everything that needs to be taught at each grade level is spelled out, and the major ideas at each grade level are really aligned to get students to be proficient in algebra by the time they reach eighth grade. So it's, I think, a major improvement. And that progression is very clear. In addition to the shifts within the content, I think there's also a greater shift within mathematical thinking and making that thinking more transparent, both to teachers and to students. So the idea that students need to be able to show and explain their work, the idea that students need to be able to reason mathematically and explain their reasoning and critique the reasoning of others, I think has also been an important shift. With the idea that we really need to get our students not just to be able to do procedures, but to actually think like mathematicians. So this is a part of that shift. Making sense of problems and persevering and solving them. Our students are being asked to do rigorous work. They're being asked to solve complex problems. And those problems are not easy. They are grade level appropriate, but we want to make sure that we're challenging our students too. If the work is too easy, it's not going to stick. Mm-hmm. So we want to make sure that our students have those experiences and that they learn to persevere with the confidence that they can tackle and solve tough problems, because that is what will enable them to be proficient in high school and then hopefully beyond high school when they go to college. Another idea that I think we're getting to in Reading more and more is the idea that students need to be involved in activities that allow them to experience mathematics as they would experience in the real world. I think when I was growing up, there were problems in textbooks that required me to suspend what I knew about the way the world works. Trains do not go on the same track in opposite directions, colliding into each other, right? So students need to be able to work on real problems that allow them to apply what they're working on and really allow them to kind of extend their understanding of the concepts. An example of that, a couple of years ago when I was teaching 7th and 8th grade mathematics, my 8th graders were studying the Pythagorean theorem. And I gave them a problem where they had to design a millennial bridge, like the one in London, over a river, had to be drawn to scale. They had to use the Pythagorean theorem as part of that. So that allowed my students to really engage in the idea of scale, as well as the application of the Pythagorean theorem, so they could understand how long each part of the bridge would be. It involved a lot of discussion between students as they were assisting one another, which I think is fine. But it gave them an idea that math isn't just something that you do in a textbook. It's something that engineers do. It's something that people do out in the real world rather than, again, in these contextual problems in a book. There are three components that are emphasized in the new standards. There is the conceptual understanding of procedures. We don't want students just doing procedures blindly, because that can actually cause a lot of difficulties. If you don't know what you're doing, if you don't know why you're doing it, how do you know you're doing it correctly? And that produces a lot of anxiety. We want students to understand what we're doing, then the procedures follow, right? And then finally, there's the application of the problem. So these three things really go together. We just don't want one or two. This is really a tripod that holds the students and really supports them.
Can I ask you to say what fluency means? What and how to give an example?
So fluency means the ability to come up with a solution or a computation quickly and easily. It isn't necessarily rote automaticity. For example, students often struggle with the multiplication fact 7 times 8. But if I know that 6 times 8 is 48, I could add another set of 8 to get to 56. That would be demonstrating fluency, even though the student doesn't have automaticity.
Okay.
So we're looking for students to use different strategies based on what they know to come up with the facts that they don't necessarily know, the things that they don't use that often. I'm really pleased to be working in a district that has math in focus because I am a Singapore person. I love Singapore. I love Singapore strategies. I think that this is a fantastic way to help students understand math. The progression of ideas go from concrete, where students are working with objects, whether they're mathematics manipulatives, whether they're paper, to a pictorial representation of the math concepts, to finally them progressing onto the abstract equations. It's a way for students to kind of anchor their thinking and anchor their understanding of a new concept before they delve into the equations, which I know when I was a mathematician in high school, the equations were a nightmare because there was nothing to kind of anchor my understanding of what those equations actually meant. This actually gives students something to hold on to, which allows them to move forward without the level of difficulty that I had. Students need to know the how and the why. Again, it's that conceptual understanding. If I understand the concept, then the procedure should make sense, right? And the idea that the manipulatives, again, are a critical component to the program. You can't teach math effectively if you're just talking at the board. Students need to be engaged at their desks with manipulatives and with each other. Conceptual understanding versus adaptive reasoning. If I really know and understand a math concept, then I can apply it in a novel situation. And that's really what we're getting at. I think the Parks assessments are getting at that as well. If students really understand addition, they should be able to apply that concept within a problem that they might not have encountered before. So that's what we really want. And then using multiple strategies, this is partly from Singapore, but the idea that I can get to fluency by applying different strategies that help with computation. For example, I recently went to a store and I had to buy objects that were $1.75 each. I was actually buying some scones for breakfast. And I had $10, I knew that I could buy 5, so great. The person behind the counter was like, I need a calculator.
Well, to the math teacher.
To a math teacher. Well, $1.75 is equal to $2 minus a quarter for each scone, right? So $2 times 5 is 10 minus $1.25 brings me to $8.75. I shouldn't need a calculator for that, right? But those are strategies that were never explicitly taught to me. I actually learned those more as I started playing around with the Singapore math program. I'm like, wow, wouldn't it be great if we actually explicitly taught this to kids so that way they could think about problems and not reach for the calculator? So that's my little story. But I recently asked my daughter a problem. My daughter's in second grade, and she wanted to know how many days until her birthday. Now, this was back in August, and her birthday's in October. And I said, well, there are this many days in September, and then you have this many left in August, so that's 36, and you're born October 8th, so add 8 more days. So what's 36 plus 8? And there's a pause in the car as we're driving down 495.
Yeah.
And then she says 44. I said, well, how do you know? She said, well, I remembered my tens friends, so I took 4 from 8, to make 40 and then added four more and got to 44. That's the kind of thinking that we want all of our second graders to be able to do. So I think if this is what we're aiming for, then we need to have a clear picture of what math instruction should look like. Recognizing that math is a study of patterns in quantity and space. That's really important. I think a lot of people forget that you wouldn't study that something that's completely random. What would be the point of that? Right? If the answers were never predictable, you wouldn't study it because you would never be sure what your answers are. So the idea that the answers in math are grounded in patterns and are predictable is actually something that's really important. Does that make sense? Right? Allowing students to develop their understandings at different levels. And the intuitive, I think the answer would be concrete, I've used materials, now I know the answer is, and that progression as they're developing their understanding of the concept to the point they're actually able to communicate. So the idea too, that's emphasized in the Common Core is that students should be able to explain their reasoning. Right? You need to be able to communicate in mathematics. And mathematics is just another form of communication. That's really important. I think differentiating instruction so that way we're helping students fill holes that they have from prior years so that way they can move forward is another key idea. And I think that where teachers are starting to wrestle with that more, so which is great because the more they wrestle with it, the better they can get, the more they can talk with their PLCs to get strategies so we can move forward as a district. So things that are ongoing within the district to help improve math instruction and help our students get where we want them to go. There's been a lot of professional development offered through Professor Mahesh Sharma, where he's teaching teachers the strategies that they need to bring into their classrooms to help kids move forward. It's amazing. It's amazing to see how clear his ideas are, and even as you're in a room with teachers, to see it, people are like, oh my God, now I get it. So it's that's been a wonderful experience. We need to develop a better understanding of the math practices to see what math instruction should look like across the district in every classroom. Not just in one building or at one grade level, but across all the buildings and all the grades. So that's another work in progress. We've started working with other districts, organizations, and coaches. Friday I had a visit to Plymouth with Tricia Stodden, the literacy coach, and it was great to have an opportunity to talk with the coaches down there to see what are some of the things that I could do to help facilitate the changes in the district, working with principals and other teachers. So next steps, assisting administrators and teachers, again, to get that clear understanding of what math instruction should look like, especially since it doesn't look like what it was when teachers were in school, right? In order to get to where we want to go, it's not going to be desks and rows with the teacher at the board. This is going to be something very different. And I think teachers need to be able to have that understanding so they can bring that back to their classrooms. We're going to be coaching teachers as they shift towards instructional practices that really engage kids and help them push their mathematical thinking again to reach that level of rigor that we want for the Common Core. I'm looking forward to helping teachers implement performance tasks. I know that some teachers probably do that, especially at the middle school level, but I would like to see that more at the elementary level, where kids are engaged in those tasks, like the bridge design project, that allow kids to really engage in the content and further their thinking, and also provide students who are struggling with an opportunity to get intervention before the end of a unit. And I think the final thought that I would like to leave with is the idea that if we raise the bar for everybody by improving the quality of instruction, then everybody moves forward, including our high needs kids. So it's really important. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks.
Can we ask questions on this part now?
Sure.
Maybe it's, yeah.
Oh, okay. So this last point I sort of have a little question on. That you feel like there's ways to create those performance tasks that hit both pieces of that, really offer that challenge aspect to sort of the students that may be at a little bit higher level, but as well, so working together in the same performance task, that it can be good for both the struggling learners and the high performing students?
What I found as a teacher was that if I sent my high level students to do it more or less independently,
yeah.
they might talk to one another.
Yeah.
If they were capable of doing it, but it gave them an opportunity to explore the material and go a little bit deeper. If I took the same performance task and offered more support to my struggling learners, it allowed them to go even further than they had gone. It helped push them. It gave them more of an opportunity to ask questions
mm-hmm.
and for me to ask them questions as they completed the task. So I think what I found was that I might create one task and I might differentiate the requirements slightly, but for the most part, all of my students were working on the same or a similar project.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of differentiating the level of difficulty, I focused more on the purpose of differentiating. And I know that I got solid results from that.
I
add something about the struggling learners part. One thing that's really been eye-opening to me that I'm not
mm-hmm.
sure I even realized, but in hearing Karen and hearing Professor Sharma, that struggling learners sometimes feel that they're just so slow. They don't understand sometimes how the advanced learners are doing this because they misunderstand that math is about memorizing procedures and they're counting. You know, the one slide you had up or talked about that, you know, has a very simple 9 plus 7,
mm-hmm.
And if you ask a student, well, what's 10 plus 6? Most of them could very easily say 16. 9 plus 7, if they don't have that one strategy of saying, oh, I know 10 plus 6, so
right.
take one from 7, it's
mm-hmm.
16. They think students are counting 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. And so the struggling learners tend to be working harder and actually having more complex mental tasks. And they just end up thinking that they're just really slow at that, when in fact they don't have the conceptual understanding and strategies that other students have.
Yeah.
So that's been really eye-opening to make sure that kids have very transparent strategies, multiple strategies available to them, and that it's not about memorizing procedures and counting. Sure, that
mm-hmm.
you want those, but that's really not going to get you into advanced mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
So that's been very eye-opening to me to have those discussions with teachers and to listen to the coaches and PD developers talk about that.
That's good. In terms of how you work with the teachers, I don't really know. I want to get an idea of like what that looks like on a daily basis. So do you, a particular teacher that might reach out to you, or you do some classroom observations, or I'm just sort of wondering. And I'm going way back now, because my boys were in fifth grade. They're 21 now, but they were in fourth and fifth grade. That was the last year when my 21-year-olds were in fifth grade. That was the last year we had a math coach. So I, when I at that level did spend time in the classroom and, just got a much better feel than you do when you have high school kids. But so I'm just wondering if you could give me a picture of sort of what it looks like, how you do that, how you get to these goals.
So it's taken some time just to get to know the district because I came from outside. What I'm starting to do now is to work with teachers, and I'm trying to find a willing person
mm-hmm.
in each building or a key person in each school
mm-hmm.
that if that person has a positive experience, that then others in the building might be able to be willing to try it out,
right,
and buy into it. I'm also going to be working more with principals,
mm-hmm,
in terms of helping them become more effective at being instructional leaders within their building. I think that's important,
mm-hmm,
because I, as one person, cannot facilitate change alone in 5 different elementary schools, and let alone the 2 middle schools.
Right.
So I think I'm going to be focused more on multiplying myself in whatever way I can, whether I'm using or communicating with PLC leaders, whether I'm talking with principals, but trying to find ways to get my ideas out in a way that is clear and helpful to the people who teach math. That's going to be my focus.
Mm-hmm.
We're also going to be employing some video segments, some model classroom, things where people can come and visit and see some lessons in progress. So we're exploring all different sorts of strategies.
Okay, great.
Linda. I was just wondering, I'm really intrigued by the idea of the same task regardless of the level of need of the learners. And I was wondering whether that encourages a conversation to happen between all of the class rather than dividing it down even more, so that the, for instance, the higher need students would be focused on one task and they'd have something in common to talk about together, but they don't have that common topic with the other learners. So it's with different tasks, it divides the class more. It just seemed like it would be another opportunity to
divides the class, but I want my students, my lower level students, need to know what my higher level students are thinking. They need to be exposed to that. They need to have the understanding that even though they might have some challenges, they are still capable of doing high level work. So I don't want to give them something substantially different. I want them, what I want to do is I want to give them the support that they need to achieve success on that rigorous task.
Mm-hmm.
Because that is what will enable them to develop the stamina to persevere.
Yeah.
It sounds like that's also a different strategy that was employed years ago, where those who found the learning easier were engaged in teaching the higher need students. And so the concern sometimes was that that's helpful. You never know something like you do after you've had to teach it.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it sometimes confined kids to the same speed that other students might learn. Whereas you said that the higher level learners were able to go in more depth through the approach you were taking.
Yes.
So I just wanted to tease apart because it's not
so
the same as it
so
used to be.
So for example, for that bridge project, my level levers, my struggling learners, my lower level students in the classroom might be required to do a bridge that might have 3 to 4 right triangles. But if they do that and they do it to scale, that's a successful task for them. My higher level students will be doing a more complex bridge design. But everybody is doing essentially the same project.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where they're seeing the common ground between them.
Makes sense. Thank you.
Thanks for having us. I'm Trisha Stodden, the literacy coach at Reading. To also talk about the shift in standards with the new frameworks, or relatively new frameworks, in the area of writing particularly. One of the big shifts is that now we have 3 genres that we need to teach students, that they're required to write both persuasive information and narrative stories. And so the shift in standards is definitely gave gave us reason, I guess, to go in the direction that we did. We have started to implement a writer's workshop. And so a lot of these anchor standards for writing are standards that that are just, they fit right into writer's workshop. So that's what I'm going to talk about. So you can see the level of writing from kindergarten, and your packet goes all the way to sixth grade. And you can see, I think it jumps out most in kindergarten, the level of writing that is one of the exemplar texts in the appendix to the frameworks. And so when I first saw that, I was like, whoa, that's pretty intense. But now that I've been spending more time in the kindergarten classrooms and seeing our teachers teach our kindergarten students, and they have like this attitude that anything's possible. And we're seeing kids, not yet at this level, it's early in the year, but students really being pushed as far as they can go individually. And so with these higher level standards, we started thinking about, you know, what best practices we can put into place for writing instruction. And these conditions of learning, immersing kids in this case, in models of writing, mentor texts, demonstrating writing in front of our kids. As teachers, anything we ask our kids to do, we're going to do ourselves. Having high expectations, clear expectations for students. And then the environment that we need for writing to happen is this acceptance of approximation, where it's not about being perfectly written, it's about the process of getting your ideas down on paper. And so working with kids in the zone of proximal development, meeting them where they are currently performing, and helping them reach to the next level with lots and lots of practice. So giving them that opportunity to take risks, make mistakes, and really get messy with the writing. And then providing constant feedback, consistent feedback, support, and celebrations. So we've been working with writing workshop officially. This year is the first year that all the teachers had the units of study published by the Teachers College off of Columbia University. And it's really not a program, even though it looks like one and it's packaged like one. it's an approach. And even the units of study are a resource for teachers in trying to make writing workshop happen in their classrooms. And so this approach encourages student independence, which is a big thing that we're encouraging with students, so that students don't raise their hand and say, I'm done, I need you to help me, that we're encouraging them to get up and get a new paper for their new story, all the way down into kindergarten, all the way up to fifth grade, building that independence where they have the strategies so they don't need the teacher to get the job done. Giving writers a high degree of choice within each of the genres, we teach the units of study, but the kids have choice, which is very motivating. If they're going to write a persuasive essay, they have a choice about what they want to write it about. And then the approach, the writing workshop model, has a regular and consistent structure so that everyday writing workshop really happens the same way. And I'll go into more detail about that. But the kids can predict it. They know how it's going to go. And they also know that it's going to happen every day, or nearly every day. And it instantly, last year we had in fifth grade, we had a visiting author from North Andover. And the one thing that he said was how impressed he was with the stamina of the kids. That when he was running a writing workshop, the kids were able to write when he asked them to write for an extended amount of time and actually enjoy it. Teachers teaching writing every day, and I already spoke to this, but it's really focusing on the process of writing and not just the finished product. Not only caring about grammar, punctuation, but really caring about the process that the kids went through. Really looking at the writer, teaching the writer the skills, but not the actual writing product. So not really caring about the essay, but caring about what skills am I teaching the student so that they can write any kind of essay in the future. Also using literature to teach the craft of writing. So using lots and lots of really rich literature and mentor text for kids to pull apart, dissect, and use as models and try to replicate in their own writing. Not copy, but use as an inspiration. And so that's how you can see this big overlap between reading and writing. So I just like this slide because in the units of study, they really are built on this progression of learning. And so right now we're doing a lot of work with teachers trying to get them to investigate more how writing gets more complex as it goes up the grades. And knowing the grade level ahead of you and the grade level behind you. So that we, because every classroom, we have students functioning at all different levels, so teachers really need to know what they're seeing so that they can help their students get to the next level. This is just a nice diagram that Karen and I have used before, but it's just this shift that we're both talking about, where it's not just teacher-led. It's really interactive. The kids are doing a lot of the work. They're talking with their writing partners. They're talking with the teachers in conferences, working on group writing projects. But it's not just that stand and deliver model. And so the lessons that are a part of writing workshop really do follow this format, where the teacher would demonstrate in some way, either by showing another model or writing herself or himself, and then giving some time with guided instruction. A lot of times in writing workshop, the kids will have partners and they'll try it out together during the lesson along with the teacher. And then the bulk of writing workshop is the kids actually practicing and writing on their own. And so what have we been doing to support teachers with this process? The units of study are relatively new to all the teachers. Some teachers have had been lucky enough to go during the last few summers for professional development, but there's a good number that we've been working with right during the school day. So we've had a couple of in-service days that we've been able to provide professional development to teachers on. And then I've been working in a lot of small groups, squeezing in grade level meetings, teachers working together on how to understand the units, how to plan their lessons, and how to better meet the needs of their students. Working in the PLCs, most recently I've been working in the kindergarten and second grade level PLC, trying to give them some more professional development on writing workshop, really the philosophy of it and why this is so important. And then a lot of individual going in and demonstrating lessons so that teachers can see what it looks like. Because the units of study are pretty dense, and in the busy days of a teacher's life, they're sometimes hard to get through, and so making it come alive for them, a lot of them are like, oh, now I get it. And so then they can start to implement their own lessons. And then these are just some of the cute pictures of all the kids in our district who are writing. Lots of kindergartners going through the process. And I think this video is not going to work, but we'll try it.
So it's about my trip to Italy, and basically it helps me.
and he's working on his story about his trip to Italy, and one of the big things for third grade is not to write about the whole trip from plane ride to plane ride and back home, but to really zoom in on one part, and so that's what he's using his story map for. And he did a really nice job just writing about the plane ride to Italy.
So can you just jump back to one of those? I was just had a question. So you mentioned that the professional development's still ongoing.
Which one?
Well, no, not in the slide, but my question is, so there was one of the slides that said that we're writing every day in every class. Is that a goal, or is that something?
This is a goal.
Okay, that's what, yeah.
It's definitely a goal. But that goes back to my work with the PLCs and trying to explain what the philosophy is. And just the other day I was at the PLC trying to explain that the secret helper in your room is teaching it in a consistent manner, because the more routine the kids get in of writing every day, the easier they just like come to the rug with their materials and they want to write every day. So
what's the timeline for the, I mean, I agree with that, and same with reading and writing go together. I mean, that's there's not enough of that. What's the?
Well, we're actually in the process of working with the administrators and the teachers on trying to get this philosophy across. We're just really fully on, you know, the first 3 months of this year. So we have to continue our education of like why it's important and how do we, you know, there's only so much time in the day. So what are we going to let go of?
And part of that is also looking at the way scheduling's done in the buildings. So that's something that I know when I first started, that was a huge concern for me, was that we weren't having uninterrupted time. Mm-hmm. So we completely redid the master schedules in the building at one end. So everybody has every day an hour of reading, an hour of writing, an hour of math uninterrupted. Mm-hmm. And it's made a huge difference in student achievement, student performance, and how the progression that we see from year to year, how much more capable the kids are going into the next grade level. So it's something that we're all looking at in all of the schools, is really looking at how we're scheduling the time in the buildings.
I think it also speaks to, I think, why we moved to this more embedded type of, you know, job embedded PD, that you know, some of the extended workshops that Tricia was talking about in the summer, that's not an option for everyone. To do just a one-day workshop can be, people can get it conceptually, but how to apply that in practice can be very different. But to have people as part of our team that's going in and saying, let me do one, I can do it for you, with your own kids. So that, as you said, people say, oh, now I see how it can work. And get the follow-up. You know, that it's not just this sort of, here's how you do it, but you try it and let's continue to follow up, you know, day after day, week after week. That's really how change happens, I think.
And that's been powerful too, having Tricia come in, and I know she's working in all the schools setting up like lab classes where teachers who are willing to have her come in and model a lesson, or they'll teach the lesson and she'll give feedback. She works with the students either in small group, or she's actually teaching the lesson, or the teacher will be teaching the lesson and then they switch off. That's been great conversation. I think being in the same position you were, I taught fourth and fifth grade for 10 years. She's taught the upper grades. So when you first go into a kindergarten class, you're like, what are they going to be able to do? And she loves now going into the kindergarten class.
It's fun. Lots of fun. They're very cute. I don't know if I could do it all day, but it's fun to go in.
But they're writing.
It's fun to go in and write with them. So these are just a few other points. So we are working with principals and teachers, trying to make a clearer understanding of writing workshop philosophy. I already really talked about the resources and collaboration. And really, we're doing a lot of work. I mean, this is our next step with the learning progressions and looking at student work and where does this piece of writing stand, no matter what grade level, where does it stand, do we all agree, and so what would be the logical next step for the student. And then just continuing professional development in this area.
Thank you.
Yes. I've got some questions. I'm just thinking about youngest is now a senior here, so it's been a long time. But I know in terms of the writing, you know, sometimes we struggled at home, you know, getting them to do the writing and sitting down. But I think it was an important struggle. I'm actually thankful for us. We did not have, in particular for boys, we did not have the Xbox anywhere near our household until they were much older. So I just, as I think about how important the reading and the writing is, and so doing it every day in school, I'm thinking back to how important at least the reading every day. We always read every day at home. And so I'm just sort of wondering, you know, what reinforcement, or, you know, does using this curriculum help with, you know, they have to do a piece of writing at home. From what you said, it sounds like they hopefully are developing skills that sort of just that focus them, but let them put it out there without maybe so much fear of it being like exactly right. I'm just recalling too many hours waiting for something to end up on that piece of paper. But I know it's really important, and I think now I can look back and say it was all worth it. But so I'm wondering if this is better. Does this make the at-home piece of it better?
The white page, the blank white page, yeah. I think really disappears. Like, I very rarely had kids say, "I don't know what to write about." That starts off, that's usually how they start off, but with the routine writing happening as often as possible, the kids really do, we give them strategies, think of a person, a place, or a thing, and something that happened. And you know, you've gotta have somebody you really care about, and so we start with that, and then something that you did with that person. I was just having that conversation with the little guys, and they're like, oh, and they go off, and they're like, I have an idea. So it's just like, they can write, I had a kid say today, I can write about anything, yeah. Really, you could write about anything, you just want them writing. So they just think about the power from kindergarten all the way up to mm-hmm. fifth grade. And even when it wasn't consistent, and I was in the fifth grade classroom, just this routine of writing as frequently as possible, the students don't, or at least it diminishes, mm-hmm. that struggle. It really does build the fluency.
The other thing I'm thinking about is, I know there's all discussions about, you know, homework, what homework is important that will help really students either whatever walk in learning or you know, help them get to the next levels. And so I think that, you know, it's important they have to be able to have that place, that routine. They have to develop that at home too, not just at school. So you know, maybe just again to get past that white page will carry over to at home.
Yeah, I think I was thinking about that when, I'm glad you brought it up, that but it came out much better when you said it. But no, I was thinking about the homework, and you know, you think of it, you know, a student comes home with homework, now they know that I got math homework, I've got science homework, I got writing homework. Maybe, and I don't know if it goes along with what Joanne said, maybe if we look at the schedule, and you know, some things lend themselves better to do at home. Maybe writing and reading is better to be able to do more of that at home, and concentrate more of the math in the classroom with the teachers. I don't know. Just
some of it is, I think, in looking at, we look at, like, is homework meaningful?
Yeah.
Does it tie into what they're doing? And really, how can writing homework, you know, to get away from the blank page. Really, we're sending kids home to be thinking about ideas to write about. So think about an important person, place, or thing. Like, those are the things you're going to be thinking about. Or in the older grades, I know they're doing persuasive. They were doing persuasive pieces this past month. So we're thinking about, you know, one of them was, should we have school uniforms or not have school uniforms? Pick a side and do some research on it. So it's not to get away from what you're saying, Elaine, is the, you know, having the kid come home and have to sit there and try and think about writing or write for a long period of time and not have any thoughts. The other piece too is we want to see the kids work, not the parents work. And that a lot of times they'll ask parents for ideas, and it may not be the ideas that the child would have come up with. So just to kind of get them brainstorming and thinking about what they're going to be writing about, and then when they come to school, they add it to their list. So this is another topic they may want to write about later, but when they go to choose topics throughout that genre, they have different topics that they choose from, but it's more teaching them to start thinking, brainstorming. They can sketch. The younger kids can just sketch out, you know, what are the beginning, middle, and end, what are the things that you want to talk about in your story, or some of the details. So it's important that they're writing every day, that they're reading every day, but I'm not saying it has to be long periods. I'm not a huge proponent of lots of homework. It needs to be meaningful. And to
I wasn't
build,
meaning at home.
Yeah, and to build writing fluency, you know, even just thinking about ideas,
I
will build it.
I think it is important that we do it at home, though. I mean, I think, you know, you have kids, they don't get from, you know, elementary school to now I'm in college and I have this intense workload and I have to be able to be productive on it without doing stuff a lot in school and at home. And so I think, you know, that's why I'm looking at that, and I'm not, well, I guess as you're talking about it, I was thinking, boy, probably some of my boys could have benefited from writing more every day in school. But I think that that at-home piece is important. And I'm just, you know, was trying to see what connections to this curriculum. It's just maybe it's, you know, a better approach overall, so that that would translate into sort of more productivity at home also.
It does build in. We don't just send them off to go write an essay.
Right.
We do one together, a class mm-hmm. essay. We do some in groups, and then they get to that independent level. So it's scaffolded all the way along through the unit. And so we're sending, if it was homework, we'd be sending pieces of it home, giving them specific strategies mm-hmm. So that they weren't like, oh, I got to write this report
right.
from scratch. It wouldn't be like that. It would be broken up.
I'm actually relieved by what you just said, because my concern right now is also on the stress that the kids are under, the pressure that they get. And I see something like this exemplar, the kindergarten exemplar, just as when I watched the video on YouTube of good schools with their exemplar of what kindergarten children ought to be able to do. And flags go up for me, because if I were the parent of a kindergarten student, as I was, and I saw that my child was supposed to be doing this, but my child was nowhere near this, because the spectrum of what kindergarten children to second grade can do, it's developmentally normal to have a large spectrum of performance and understanding there, and the realization that writing entails not just the story they come up with, but being able to form the letters, being able to put them in sequence, getting beyond the spelling, all the mechanics. When children take it home and we parents are faced with our children trying to task this out, my concern is that we can very unintentionally turn your message of whatever you write is fine, you know, not, well, to what you were saying, you're trying to enable the children to approach a blank page and not have the fear about what they're going to put down. And we as parents sometimes can get in the way of that, because we have our exemplars and we have our concerns that come out. So I love that they're being enabled and that the pressure is down and filling the white page with something that's meaningful for them. I guess the question that's the tag question is there an instruction piece for parents too, so that they can understand how to support the work you're doing in school and not inadvertently create obstacles?
Yeah,
that makes sense.
We've talked about that as one of the steps that we need to take, along with administrators and teachers. Of course, parents are in that group.
and there are things that we can do, and those exemplars are not necessarily Reading's exemplars. Those exemplars come from MASS frameworks, and so we have exemplars that we're working with teachers developing what we feel is developmentally appropriate. The actual units of study come with book writing pathways that has a learning progression with examples, and we're actually in the discussion process right now, like, do you think this is kindergarten, like, do you feel like this is a good end of the year kindergarten piece, first grade piece, second grade piece, and that's the work we're doing. And so giving kids the strategies to move, clear expectations, we have checklists and setting goals with kids, so there's that balance of, you know, not being too harsh, like, so they don't want to write anything down, but also, you know, showing them and holding them accountable for things that they have learned. So there's that fine balance.
I just wanted to reinforce to one of the slides you had with the arrows, you know, showing that it wasn't just the teacher. I've loved seeing the overlap, you know, and how you two have collaborated, you know, with that, whether it's math, whether it's literacy, that approach, that there's that overlap, that the teacher is facilitator for that type of student-centered approach, and that's not just a strategy like telling the kids, oh, now turn and talk, uh-huh, but actually teaching the kids and scaffolding how to do that well. It's almost a metacognitive sort of understanding by giving them the language, you know, so that, you know, they're gradually learning to say, well, I agree with Tricia when she says this, but, you know, what did you read that made you think of that? Or how did you, I mean, they're learning prompts and sentence stems of how do you actually have discourse about your own learning? Mm. Kids get better and better at that as they progress, and so that gives them avenues into solving their own problems later. And it's also exposing the different strategies and reasonings of other people. That's what we do as adults, as we understand more, and so to teach kids to do that. And that's happening whether it's math or science or English or whatever, and that's nice. The term for that, what, accountable talk, you gave some presentation, you know, and kids be accountable for their own learning. They're learning how to talk about their learning.
Just one other quick question, just about the, what about the, you know, like lab sort of science or technical, like lab writing, is that part of this, or is that really like when the fifth grade or fourth or fifth grade teachers are doing science, they might be then introducing that more scientific or lab structured format?
There's a lot of cross content writing, so some of the examples are, you know, if they're doing a persuasive piece in both the science and social studies class, I saw, so kids were doing a persuasive argument, one on a social studies topic and one on a science topic. So we're always looking for the cross-content connections. They'll do it, they'll even apply some of the writing that they're doing, narrative writing with guided reading. So they may take on the perspective of one of the characters and write a story, maybe with a different ending from that character's perspective. So there's always ways to incorporate, because we want them writing every day.
As we look at the resources that we use to align with the next generation science standards and stuff, and what we're piloting right now in fifth grade, has a strong literacy, both reading and writing component to it.
Yeah, we went over that last spring. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So no Adams,
no Adam.
Okay, so that has literacy, sort of the literacy of science sort of in that,
yeah,
curriculum.
And it's important to note that even the state framework, the literacy standards, is not just ELA.
Right.
It applies,
it's throughout.
All across.
It's social,
right,
studies,
right,
and,
right,
English.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you.
Well,
thank
done.
You.
Thank you.
That's all we got for tonight.
Well, just for the public that may have came in late, we... unfortunately, for unforeseen circumstances, didn't have a quorum tonight. We will be meeting again, and we're posted to meet Wednesday, December 23rd. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.